Scott Thornbury here, who's very kindly agreed to take some time out of his extremely busy schedule here in Japan at the JOLT conference. So can I get this right? This is what I understand. You're from New Zealand.
Uh-huh.
You're living in Spain.
That's right.
You're teaching in New York.
Well, teaching online through for a university based in New York most of the year, and teaching face-to-face in New York in the summer.
Okay.
Yeah, so a global existence.
Yes, it must be a lot of fun.
Teaching online is more fun than I thought it would be.
Mm.
And having the face-to-face as well sort of is a nice compensation. But in fact, I was pleasantly surprised how easy, although very time-consuming, but also how constructive teaching online can be.
Mm.
I'm really, really enjoying it.
I wanted to ask you a little bit about some technology things later on.
Uh-huh.
But I've been looking back at some of your books before I came to talk to you, and also your plenary that you talked about, different ways of looking at grammar.
Right.
And you go back to about language, natural grammar, simply grammar.
Yeah. These are your book titles. I've written five books with the word grammar in the title, to my shame. So I've inevitably therefore typecast as some kind of grammar guru,
well,
but I don't set myself up to be. Is that...
That was kind of what I was going to ask you. Why did you start to focus on that area, and how do you feel about it?
I think it's because the profession is so focused on it. And I think as a teacher trainer, which is where I got, if you like, the motivation and a little bit of the authority to talk about methodology, having trained so many trainers over the years. That was one of the things, of course, that people feel, well, a lot of teachers feel very insecure about. I remember actually when I was writing the book, which is called How to Teach Grammar, I met a teacher trainee of mine a trainer I'd just trained on a train in Barcelona, and he was going off to his teaching job. And I said, how's the teaching going, Clive, or whatever his name was? And he said, fine, but I wish I knew more about how to teach grammar. And I said, well, funny you should say that, because I'm writing a book called How to Teach Grammar.
Mm.
But it is one of these preoccupying things. Now, I don't think that's necessarily all we do, and I don't think it's necessarily all we should do.
Mm.
But it does seem to be one of the things that sort of really challenges teachers, especially initially, or for which, after a while, they want new ideas or new ways of thinking. And this new ways of thinking about grammar is also has important implications on new ways of thinking about methodology and vice versa.
So what would you say your approach is to grammar? Because it's perhaps not the traditional...
No, I think more and more my approach to grammar is to approach grammar from the point of view that it doesn't exist. In a sense that the distinction, as I was saying yesterday, the plenary between lexis or vocabulary and grammar has become, it's kind of really... they've been talking about this for years now, but it's really broken down. There's this huge fuzzy area, apart from anything else, in the middle of which we now call kind of phraseology or whatever. But in a sense, it's a continuum from words to collocations to phrases or formulaic language through to grammar. And grammar just seems to me, seems to a lot of people now, it's just another form of collocation. And where do you draw the line? I use the example quite often of structures like was plus ing, which we call grammar because we call it the past continuous, was shopping, etc. But what about a structure like go plus ing, as in go shopping?
Mm.
Isn't that a structure too? I mean, it's kind of more like vocabulary, so that goes into the vocabulary section of what. What about an expression like go and plus infinitive, as in go and ask, go and tell, go and see? What do you call that? Well, that's more grammar but it's all just different forms of collocation. It's really all about frequency, the very, very frequent ones, the ones that become sort of, in a sense, have sort of fossilized into grammatic forms. We now call, that's the kind of traditional grammar, but really language learning is all about learning all the other kinds of grammar as well.
So what did you think of James Lantoff's plenary?
Well, I mean, first of all, it was wonderful to have seen him. Perhaps I've been reading a lot of about the stuff that he's helped popularize. Certainly at a fairly academic level, but nevertheless, he's the person who's kind of brought Vygotsky and social cultural theory into the discourse of language teaching through a number of his extremely important books and collections. So it was wonderful to see him, in the flesh. That's the great thing about conferences. And also, actually, what I even enjoyed more than the plenary, he had a question and answer session the night, the evening before, which was a really wonderful interactive and session. And it was very consistent with this idea of, that in a sense, it is the heart of social cultural learning, that all learning is socially constructed, and that you saw it happening in that room, which you don't really see in a plenary, of course, because it's sort of more detached. But that was great.
It seemed to me that, that some of the things that he was talking about were quite different to the way that you approached him. I'm talking about the SCOBAs and that, you know, he was pulling out structures.
Oh, well, that's interesting. Yes, I must admit, yes, it's a good point, actually. Yes, it's very much, his approach seems to be, and the way he interprets Vygotskian theory is that, that language rules are tools which help learners internalize or appropriate the language, and it's therefore it's good to have rules, and the rules should be exact, and this is all part of scientific scientific concepts. I'm less convinced that this kind of very deductive approach, or the implications of what he's saying, or could be misinterpreted as saying we should go back to the deductive teaching of rather difficult rules. And I asked him about that the night before his question and answer thing. Well, at least shouldn't these rules, wouldn't they be more accessible if they were in the learner's L1? And he kind of conceded that that was the case. But we seem to be kind of coming right back to some kind of grammar translation.
Well, I assume that was the case, because when the example he gave of some people learning Spanish, I assumed that those reactions were given in English by English-speaking learners of Spanish. Some of those that you pointed out, and that would make sense if you're going to use that approach.
Yeah, it raises some very interesting questions, but I'm glad they've been raised. I'm not sure that his suggested answers are necessarily the ones that I would suggest. But.
Well, you mentioned that you've been reading a lot of around in that area, but would it be fair to say that, that part of your position in the world of ELT is to read a lot and reinterpret in a way that is palatable and understandable? Because I take the book that you've produced quite recently with Luke Meddings at the Teaching Unplugged, and in the first sort of chapter, the first 10, 15 pages or so, there's a fantastic bibliography, and it just struck me that you were really talking about focus on form.
Well, talking about focus on form, and the rest, I think. That's the thing. No, I think, well, the opportunity to write that book, or that write the introduction to that book, was a wonderful sort of sense-making exercise for me, because really what it did was bring together a number of different threads that have been running through my own thinking about teaching, about teaching grammar, and about the whole dogma thing that's been going on now for 10 years. And it was to sort of say, well, listen, where are we at now? What are the theories that are informing? When I wrote How to Teach Grammar, when that came out in 1999 or whatever, it's 10 years on now, and what I'd really dearly love is to be able to write that book and incorporate much more the kind of stuff that Lantoff is talking about, social cultural learning, mediated learning, appropriacy, other regulation, all this sort of stuff, because it seems to me that's what grammar learning is all about, and consider these things head on. So the opportunity to write that introduction to Teaching Unplugged was great, because it helped me bring together a number of these different threads. Including the notion of emergent pedagogy, emergent grammar, etc., which comes from another sort of feeder field, which is complexity theory, systems theory, that's being promoted by Diane Larson-Freeman, among others. And you know, I can see, and also corpus linguistics, the effect of that's having on the way that we look at language description. So there's all sorts of stuff going on out there, and I'm trying to make sense of it in my own head.
And for others, I think, because it was a wonderfully clear. It was very written. And there was a phrase in there which I highlighted, and you mentioned it. You used the phrase again in your plenary, actually. It's not rocket science.
And teaching.
But sometimes, you know, all that applied linguistics and all that SLA theory makes and that research is very important, but very complex.
It's slightly daunting, exactly, and guilt-inducing even, if you, you think, oh my God, I need to know more and more about more and more, but not really. I mean, you know, the instincts that have guided teachers over generations and thousands of years are probably the correct instincts. Good teaching is good teaching is good teaching, it always has been.
Well, you mentioned the dogma thing, and we can't really ignore that, I guess. It's something very, very...
Associated with, yes.
You've got three core precepts. It's conversation driven, it's materials light, and it focuses on emergent language. How would you, what would you say to someone who wants to implement this kind of approach, but for whatever reason, institutional reasons, cultural reasons, or class sizes or so on, was finding it difficult?
Well, I think then we perhaps should add a fourth kind of, what's it, maxim or whatever, which is to say it is also context sensitive. In other words, you don't do anything. Good teaching is not riding roughshod over the expectations of the learners or the parents or the institution. You do what you can. What we're saying is you have permission to do what you can because it's good. So you, there is, if there is an opportunity to take advantage of something that spontaneously comes up in the classroom, even if you don't necessarily have to engineer it, but if something comes up, then you needn't feel bad about developing it, because actually that's possibly where real learning opportunities, or what students will remember, is situated. And so it's all about, yeah, adapting to your context. But maybe, I mean, there was a fantastic posting yesterday on the Dogma site by somebody who'd never posted before, relatively new teacher, I mean, hadn't been teaching long, and she just told a story about how she had taken that risk, and it was based on something she read in Teaching Unplugged. It's extremely gratifying to get that kind of feedback from a book, incidentally, when people say, I did this exercise and it really worked, I did this activity and it really worked, give or take. I mean, she was quite candid about it, but I mean, it was fantastic that somebody's doing that, experimenting with their practice in a relatively, you know, new and possibly insecure stage of their career. And I think that's wonderful, when, and that's what I want. That's what I want to do as a teacher trainer, say to them, listen, you're a fantastic teacher, but like, how about doing it differently? Because otherwise you're just going to get fed up of that, you know, of teaching, if you just keep being fantastic in that particular way. Try, you know, be fantastic in some other way.
Do you think this approach is well, it's probably fair to say it's easier for an experienced teacher.
Yeah.
But it's not out of the question for someone who's new.
I mean, I've often said this, that I've talked about Dogma on certificate courses, i.e. pre-service courses, and I've talked about Dogma on diploma courses, i.e. in-service courses, and often the response on the pre-service courses is actually more welcoming, in a sense, or more interested than on the in-service courses, where people feel slightly threatened by the idea that they might have to go in, you know, with less prepared or fewer materials. Whereas I think it's a lot of teachers, there's a generation of people coming through now who have actually experienced in other disciplines, other subjects, have to experience as students an education which hasn't been driven by materials or hasn't been driven by explanation or lecturing or whatever. And so they're actually quite well disposed to the notion of Dogma.
Do you think there's an optimum kind of context or condition for Dogma?
No, I don't think there is. I mean, I think if you think of Dogma as being less a methodology and more a kind of activity type, then of course it can happen anywhere. Or what we refer to, or has been referred to, as dogma moments, that they can, as I said, it can occur in the crevices of lessons, the things that occur. Lots of stuff goes on in classrooms when the door is closed that nobody ever knows about, except for the people in the room. So I don't think there's a sort of, well, there's optimal conditions where you have the complete freedom to do what you want and design your own syllabus, or if you're teaching, you know, you're your own boss and you want to take a risk, then, you know. But I don't think there's any situation where you couldn't, you know, incorporate some kind of, at least some one of those three principles into your practice. Even if you have to use a course book or lots of materials, you can nevertheless also use the course book to provide opportunities for language to come up that was not necessarily planned or anticipated, and then work with it.
So you're teaching online, you're all over Twitter, you've got your own website. Why does there seem to be, from certain Dogma enthusiasts, there seems to be this kind of debate between, what should we say, the nerds and the Luddites, the geeks and the, you know, the people who are obsessed, who love technology, and those who think that, you know, we should sit under a tree and teach with whatever's in our pockets. What do you think about technology?
Well, I use technology outside of the classroom simply because, or as an alternative classroom where a face-to-face classroom is not available. For training teachers, I mean, again, it's not optimum. You need, finally, at some point in your training, you need somebody in the classroom with you, watching your class, co-teaching or whatever. But there's a lot of mileage can be got out of online teaching, as I've discovered. So I have nothing against the technology, and the technology is working increasingly to favour this kind of medium.
Mm.
For me, that offers actually the bonus of technology is that, in fact, means that so much of language learning can be done outside the classroom.
Mm.
And there's all sorts of means of doing that. I mean, you know, obviously reading and listening, there's a huge wealth of materials that just that students need to be directed and trained how to use them.
Mm.
But I mean, even then, there's stuff out there that, you know, it's not hard to find. It's just really, really good and useful, fantastic stuff. But that, in a sense, liberates, it seems to me, that liberates the classroom for the uses for which the classroom is ideally suited, which is the social, the real face-to-face stuff, where you can actually clear everything out of the classroom and just have some chairs you actually need. But I'm not averse to, you know. I mean, I like the idea of people having... I've taught in smart, wired-up rooms myself, and I know it's wonderful to be... The question comes up, somebody says, like, I'm on a training, I'm teaching... training some teachers in language analysis, and somebody says, is it correct to say, I'm loving it? That's in the McDonald's slogan. We say, well, let's have a look. Let's see if there's any other examples of that form of, you know, of the verb love and the continuous aspect online. So we go straight online, go to a corpus, blah, 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 have a look. We don't find any lovings, but we find some likings and some enjoyings and some knowings and some whatever. That's fantastic tool. If you can access it rapidly and then put it aside. So, I mean, I like that way of integrating the existing technology. I'm sort of a little bit bored of this argument now because it's going
to
be running and running. We do need to move on and think how you can integrate technology but still be consistent with the principles which I believe are pedagogically sound, those three principles that you enumerate. The only reason a material's light is one of those principles is simply materials tend to get in the way. Materials tend to get in the way. When I'm saying technology gets in the way, if technology is only being used to simply introduce more materials into the classroom willy-nilly in the service of, you know, the traditional grammatical syllabus, then we're back to square one.
Well, so let's talk about materials in general then. You haven't written a textbook, have you?
I have. I mean, it's my experience of years ago having written textbooks or co-written textbooks, which has made me realise how difficult it is to write a textbook because it's so consumer-driven and market-driven. Well, not consumer-driven. The students don't have any say in the process and the marketing. It's the teachers and the... but I mean, the whole thing is very, very difficult. It's very rigid. It's very difficult to innovate within that model. And I, you know, that's reasonable. Publishers invest an enormous amount of money in textbooks. They have to make them look nice. But it means that there's very little flexibility in terms of anybody wants to do anything vaguely different. So I got kind of fed up with that.
I was going to say, would you do another one?
I don't think I would actually. No. Not unless there's a major paradigm shift. I mean. I was involved in an online course. And so when in the mid-90s or late-90s, when everything was going online, the internet, and let's put together some online delivery, we did that, a group, and it was a very rewarding experience in terms of what we had to learn, not just about technology and what was available and what could be done, but also how you have to kind of reinterpret the whole model. Because we still come from this very default model of there's a course book. Well, let's put a course book on the internet. Well, it's really not perhaps the best way of using the medium. But the experience was very, very rewarding from that point of view. Just as the experience of teaching this online MA has been very rewarding. But, you know, you've got to keep moving on.
I wanted to ask you, actually, I found an older article of yours, which resurfaced, as you mentioned, on Twitter, the one about window dressing versus cross-dressing. I really like this quote, because one of the problems that you said, and that I agree with, actually, that we have with textbooks, is that they're so concerned with the form, with the grammar McNuggets, as you put it, very succinctly. You know, content exists solely as vehicles for language presentation and practice. Their capacity to engage the learner cognitively or effectively is a secondary concern, hence their banality. And this leads to things like, you know, complete invisibility of gays and lesbians in textbook or, you know, content is there because you have to put something there and it serves only the grammar. So what should we be talking about?
Well, I'm not even convinced. In fact, in that article, I wasn't arguing that there needs to be explicit content that's about taboo subjects. You're never going to sell books which have, not for a mainstream market or on a global market, you're never going to have books which have, say, explicit same-sex couples in them. But I think some more risk could be taken, even in the design of books, to allow teachers who wanted to develop those themes. Or, I don't know, there's something incredibly anodyne about the people in course books. Or if they're not anodyne, they're incredibly famous. So there seems to be no kind of, where are the normal strange people? Yeah. As to, and, it's partly because they're there to deliver Grammar McNuggets, really. It's the least of their worries is to convey any particular values or to engage the learner with the content. I mean, that's being a little bit unfair. I mean, I think course book writers fall up, you know, bend over backwards to try and find stuff that's engaging and interesting. But actually, you know what? All the engaging and interesting stuff is out there on the internet. So why have the texts and the books anyway? And what's the good of them? In fact, you know, you look at it, what is the book good for? Well, it's got the text, and we get the text on the internet, the exercises. Well, you know, I mean, there's only a finite number of exercises and activities, and there are resource books and methodology books are packed with them, and websites, etc. The syllabus, it comes down to the syllabus. People say, well, we need a course book, we need a syllabus. What's the syllabus doing? Simply delivering these Grammar McNuggets in a kind of random kind of way, not when they're necessarily needed. You sort of wonder why we have books at all, really. Why is it? I mean, other disciplines have books, perhaps they need them. Maybe geography, maths, history, they have to have books. I don't know whether we have to have books in a language class. I mean, language is a means, not a subject. And we need to provide a rich learning environment where language is the means.
Doesn't it come down to, do you think that the bottom line is people need to be tested or seem to be tested and assessed?
Yeah, that's what education's all about. Yeah. It's all about testing and it's all about accountability.
So what kind of testing and assessment should we be doing?
Oh, none. I mean, you know, if you ask me.
Either way, yeah.
But I mean, you know, I'm a...
But if we can't change the world...
Well, I said, you know, testing. You test people's ability to do things with language, not what they know about language. I mean, that's one thing. So you have holistic testing, you have integrative testing, you have testing of skills, etc. But it's very difficult to do. But you know, it's not impossible. You get look at the big exams like Cambridge First Certificate. I mean, they test people's ability to speak as well as to read and write. It's not impossible. There's a lot of organisations. It's very expensive, but it's a fair test. I mean, you're going to have tests.
So, last question. I'll let you get on. Uh-huh. What's next? What are you doing at the moment?
What am I doing? I'm doing a lot of editing of books as I work as the. I'm the editor of this Cambridge Handbook series, so that's always an ongoing thing, as well as the teaching, etc. I'm not writing any new books at the moment. I'm writing some articles for things, same old stuff. I've just got an article coming out on corpus linguistics in a collection that's been published by Routledge, and I'm kind of proud of that because that's a new departure. I'm just enjoying the teaching, really, the online teaching, and we'll see. I'm not sure what's on the horizon. I'm enjoying being in Japan at the moment, too. That's
the
great discovery.
Time,
for the first time, long overdue.
Yeah.
I hope to be back.
Well, we're very glad to have you here, Scott.
Thank you, Darren.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.